then after your brilliant speech on stress, I'm super stressed. Because we have a lot of good speakers today. We have a politician, we have an academician, we have a psychiatrist. We just had a brilliant speech from a stand-up comedian. And yet I've been introduced as a country manager of a company. Now my identity is attached to a company. So what am I good at? What good am I to teach you or to preach you something? So I was very confused that who am I? What am I good at? After all these experience with all these companies, am I really worth a TED talk? So allow me to take you through my journey, because I was trying to discover who actually I am over the last 40 years. Newsflash, I had been diagnosed with ADHD at the very beginning of my career. And those of you who don't know, ADHD is attention deficiency and hyperactive. So I have severe attention deficiency. And of course, like many of you, as you mean, I am very good at procrastination. The word later is a synonym in my life. The last time I edited this presentation was at 3 p.m. when someone was speaking, and I gave the slides to him in Google. So I do things at the last moment. Of course, I had a very good starting of my academic career. I am an IUTian. But I studied the wrong subject, mechanical engineering. I know what you mean. But if you take my procrastination and ADHD into account, mechanical engineering was hell for me. The labs, the hours, the studies, and the exams stressed the hell out of me. And then, even then, I got into one of the most sought after company in the country. You know by the logo. I worked with some of the best professionals. I worked with some of the best mentors who still are my mentor, but yet I did the wrong job. Mechanical engineering. I was in fact the first IUTian to be the chief supervisor in that company. But I did not enjoy it. The payment was superb. The people were amazing, and yet I couldn't see myself doing that job for the next 30 years. So I'm still a nobody. Like a lot of people here, I'm not somebody. Then I moved, after 1.5 years, I moved to one of the biggest telecom operators in the country. And there, fortunately, I got the right job. I was the brand manager of that brand. It was fierce competition back in 2006, 2007, and 2009. There were a lot of other telcos. I really loved what I did, which is consumer behavior, seeing what the consumer would like to see, and creating those communication that you see the real impact. And yet, I had a very bad boss. A boss who didn't like me. A boss who liked others above me because I was not very good at, you know, the corporate thing. So I went to a very good company. I did a great job, but I'm still a nobody because my boss didn't like me. Next up, I went into a WiMAX company, and it started its journey in 2009. Now there, I loved my job. I was the head of brand. We did some amazing work, and my boss was good. But after 3 years, I had to leave that job because the technology went out of business. Not a lot of company globally invested on WiMAX. But even though the brand had a lot of potential, the business sustained. Now, I'm still a nobody. I started asking myself, is it me who is the problem, or is it something else? So by this time, I have had a lot of experience. I've had engineering, company, mentorship, leadership, as well as marketing. So I said, okay, I'll do my own startup. So many, probably some of you have heard of this. So the startup called Dhaka Foodies. And we started this concept back in 2015 called Seri Night. Now in Hotel Rajyak, there was a lot of people were going there for Seri. And I started asking myself that why people at 2 a.m. at night is going to Hotel Rajyak, putting their car almost 2 kilometers away and holding on to another chair just to get a seat for the Seri. And then I realized, because during iftar, it's crowded, you are hungry, and you don't want to see another people when you're having iftar. So it's actually at the night when people are happy, they can have Seri, and the roads are empty. And it's a perfect environment to have a get together. So what Seri Night did, what it made a perfect platform for all the get togethers. So for the 3 years consecutively, Seri Night was a massive success. Unfortunately, last year, police didn't let me do Seri Night because of various reasons. Now, although this startup was a success, I couldn't do a sustainable business model. I was too heavily dependent on events. If there's no event, there's no money. Although Dhaka Foodies has a website, everybody went to Facebook and not there. So it's a failure. And at the same time, with other people, I tried different ventures as well. What people see is Dhaka Foodies as a success. But what they don't see, that I have been trying startups since 2010 in the name of a digital agency, a catering business, even a food juice, a juice brand, which didn't launch. So after all this experience, I have consulted for the one of the biggest transformation in the telecom industry. I've been head of innovation. So I have been into a lot of projects. But at the same time, I teach at Brack University 4 days a week at 8 a.m. in the morning. I go there, I teach one class, and then I go back to my job. And at the same time, I've been doing photography. And recently, I've just had my own solo exhibition. But I am a full-time... job holder. I had to be called country manager of this. I'm still not a faculty. I'm still not a photographer. I'm an adjunct faculty, and I'm a part-time photographer. So I'm still a nobody, right? If I come here 2 years later, I might still be a country manager or CXO or a company, and I might still not be a nobody. So who am I? So what I've discovered is, for me, being nobody is my comfort zone. It's okay to not be a specialist into everything. I might be the jack of all trade, master of none, but I'm happy with that. Because what I do is I've been gaining experience from different industry, different genre, different consumers, and I try to connect the dots. So the black spot that you see is where I exist. I went to the mosque for prayer, and I was observing everyone praying. So I tried to remember when I was a student, what are the differences? The only difference I saw is a lot of faces stuck onto the mobile screen. So that is a very easy difference to see, right? But another difference that I noticed, which is no one was having that coronavirus mask. What you will see, okay, you were there, okay, I missed you, probably the only one. But nobody in the entire mosque, although they are in the crowd of all the unknown people, no one was wearing a mask. Whereas if you go to a shopping mall, a food court or wherever, even in class, you might see someone wearing a mask. Now, why do I see that? It's because of my exposure, my experience, and my thinking with diverse set of people. So I may look like a receding hair white guy, white hair guy with wrinkles who is 40-year-old, but inside me, I'm still that 23-year-old, just like you. I still feel the same energy because I mix with so many people every day, every hour. So what if I wake up tomorrow morning and all of a sudden I see myself in a 23-year-old body but with a 40-year-old head. Would I do things differently? Will I choose things so that it makes me somebody and nobody? Let's see. For example, of course I will work as a 23-year-old. I need some company experience, but I will not go for the right brands or big companies. I look for the right leader. I'll research the hell out of LinkedIn and I'll try to find out who is the right guy under whom I can learn a lot. No matter which company he or she works for, I'll just make sure I'll go and work for him or her. Point. Of course, I did a lot of startup, but in future, if I do any startup or as a 23-year-old person, I'll make sure the idea gives back to the society. Because we see the startup or innovation has become a jargon, but none of it sustains if it's giving back to the society. The cycle completes. That's very important. I will not have my Facebook app on my mobile because it's a complete distraction. And I will go and visit as many places as possible, something that I probably can't do as a 40-year-old person. And it doesn't mean I'm going to Bali or Greece. I'm talking about maybe a village, maybe a community, maybe some place where I get to mix with people who can teach me something. Now, I know you come across this very often, but trust me, the learning that you can get being just a silent person in that community is the most rewarding learning ever. Of course, I will continue teaching and photography, but probably I will do it in a different mode. I will teach on YouTube, because what I see that all the physical experience that I have, if I can create content on YouTube, that can create more impact for more people. So that's probably something that I will do. Of course, I will marry the same girl. It's because with all my deficiency, all my attention disorder and hyperactiveness, she's the person who understood me before anyone else. So as a 23-year-old, I'll probably go to her earlier, faster, and convince her to marry me so that I can have a bit more marriage life with her. And of course, I have 3 boys at this moment. I'll probably try to convince her to make some more kids. And there's a reason. No. The reason is, when you grow old, it's stress all around, Dhaka city, everywhere. But when you go home, when you see these kids, it's a whole different experience. And everything just goes away. For me, the kids, each kid are a startup. Because each kid gives you a different challenge. They're a different human being, a different character. And they bring out the best of you. So if I have the opportunity, I'll try. Right now, my wife won't agree. But if I were young, and if I could, I would create more children. So to sum up, I'm still a nobody. Probably 10 years down the line, I'll still be a nobody. But I'll be happy because I coexist in different environments. That is the environment where I find most of my inspiration and I create solutions accordingly. Thank you so much.